things you have to put up with me to lead the songs this time with Caleb out. And so we want to share some things with you from Psalms chapter 106. And as we look in this verse here, I trust that it'll help us with some problems. And you know, it amazes me, and I'm sure it does you too, but how many times have you met somebody, it was like they were asking for trouble? And I found that this is true of not just the world, if you please, but many Christians. A lot of times we do things asking for trouble. And now a lot of times when you're asking for this particular thing or you're thinking about it, you don't think in terms of, well, this is going to cause me some trouble. But when you start thinking about it, especially as we look at it from God's Word, we'll see that many times that's exactly what we're doing. We're asking for trouble. And so here as we look in Psalms 106, verse 15, listen close to what it says here. And he gave them their request. And folks, how many times have we prayed for something and God has given it to us? And how many times maybe have we asked somebody for something and then they gave it to us? And how many times have we thought, that's what we really need? So it says, and he gave them their request, but he sent leanness into their soul. And of course, the Lord's referring to when Israel was in the wilderness and things that were happening, and God went ahead and supplied them with the food and various other things. But there came a leanness within because, again, their attitude and their spirit toward God was not right at all. And folks, how dare us think that God owes us a living, that God owes us something? And folks, it's just the opposite. We owe God everything. We owe him our soul, our being, everything that's wonderful in our life has come from God. And so simply as we look at this verse again, God gave him the request, but a leanness came. And so many times we ask for things, and folks, we end up asking for trouble. And so our message today is just simply entitled, Are You Asking for Trouble? And many sayings that come to mind, and I found out that some of the sayings I share with you, I guess strictly from Texas, but anyhow, bear with me. And then some, they are more international. But most of us try and we borrow trouble. And many times it's a shame that we'll take it upon ourselves to be troubled about something that's happening to someone else and it's not even really happening to us. And so we borrow trouble. But sometimes we ask for it. There's an old saying that goes like this, don't trouble trouble until trouble troubles you. Mm-hmm. You ever heard that? That's been heard all the way this far north. Okay, all right. So we want to share with you, but in spite of that saying, most of us seem to just ask for many of our troubles. So you ever heard somebody say something like this? His biggest problem is himself. You ever heard that? Okay, I have many a time. I don't know why they're always pointing at me when they say that. But anyhow, but what I'm trying to say, isn't it amazing some of the things that we do and how that we do have a tendency to get in trouble. So before we go any further, I want to ask God's blessing upon our message today and our time together. And I want to ask Brother Bob, if he would, to lead us in prayer. Brother Bob.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we ask you to bless this time we're spending together to hear your word, Lord. Just open our hearts and minds to hear it, Lord, and give the pastor the words to speak. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Bob. I appreciate that. And when we look here in God's word, there's several men that really jump out as people that had trouble, had problems. And of course, one of the first men that comes to my mind is a man named Job. And then I think of another guy that was actually a preacher. Maybe I identify with him a little bit more, but his name was Jonah. And Jonah, the interesting story about him being swallowed by a whale. And you've heard the story many times, I'm sure. But in Jonah chapter 1, it tells us several things about him. But one of the things I want to get across to you right now, and again, to help us to see if we're bringing trouble upon ourselves when we shouldn't be doing that, was simply this. We ask for trouble when we run from God. When we run from the Lord, we're asking for trouble. And so you might say, well, what are you referring to? I'm so glad you asked that question. But sometimes we think, well, I really can't afford to give to God, and God understands that, and God knows that. Well, I can't really afford to go to all the church services, and especially now with gas, it costs so much. Well, I really can't, you know, and I can start going down a list of things, and what I'm saying is many times we run away from God because we feel like God can't help us financially, and because we feel like, well, we don't really need to be in every service. And we just start looking at all these different things. And so what happens is we're running away from what God wants us to do, what God expects from us. Folks, you're asking for trouble when you run from God. and felt we can't afford to run from him. We need to run to him, and if you please, run for him and not against him. And so again, when I think of Jonah, we find that he got caught in a storm. And folks, you ever get caught in a storm? Yesterday when I went running, I was out at the park out here, and at the park out there by 31, and I got started, and next thing I know, it just started raining, and I thought, no big deal, I've run in rain before, and I even got caught a number of times in lightning storms, and he said, "Preach, that's not real smart." Well, it wasn't lightning when I started, okay, you know, anyhow, and if you got, you know, if you're out so far, one time I was out 5 miles from the house, so I had another 5 miles to go, and man, I got real close to God that time, but anyhow, what I'm trying to say is, it's suddenly the rain just started coming down harder and harder. And no big deal, a little bit of water's not going to hurt me. And then next thing I know, it was going straight into my eyeballs. So I went, oh, this can't hurt. And it started stinging. So I thought, well, I'm going to go back and run in the church building. So anyhow, it's terrible. I'm always telling kids, don't run in the church. And then I come up here and I run in it. But anyhow, I don't have anybody to run into. But what I'm trying to say is that we've been in storms. And have you ever noticed after a storm, a lot of times there'll be trees and branches just laying everywhere and all sorts of things that happen from the storm? And again, because of the power of the storm, or maybe you even lost your electricity during that storm. But many times there's other storms, and it may be maybe a financial storm in your life. Maybe it might be some sort of health issue that could be a tremendous storm. And pray for Martha. She goes in for surgery this Tuesday. They go in to remove some polyps, and they are pre-cancer, so we're glad to get rid of these, and so just pray for us. She goes through this, and that she'll be up and around again just real soon. But anyhow, all that said, there's just a lot of things going on, and how many of you, I mean, if I were to ask for a show of hands, probably almost every hand would go up that, yeah, I've gone through a health storm. And then if I were to say, how many are going through a financial storm, and you'd have to raise your hand again, and we could just go down the list, all the lines, and how many have just gone through maybe some sort of family problem, some sort of family storm that you've gone through, and we could go on and on. But I think almost every one of us could raise their hand, and maybe some of them, we've got several here in our church today right now, and they're looking for a home, they're looking for a house, they're out of the home right now, and so they're looking for some places to live. And so we've been praying for them on a regular basis, haven't we, for some of our people. And thank the Lord for the ones that have gotten homes recently. But what I'm trying to say is there's a lot of storms. And there's a lot more storms than we have a tendency to give credit to. And then as I say that, how many of us have gone through some spiritual storms? And maybe things have happened in such a way, and maybe it was actually a physical storm, or maybe it was a financial storm, or a health storm. But as we got into it, we begin to question ourselves spiritually. And we begin to have some doubts that we were dealing with. And so what do we do? Instead of going directly to God, we ran away from God. And how sad that is. We find that Jonah, he got caught in the storm. And during that storm, several things happened. In fact, he said this. He said, this is all happening. It's my fault that's happening, that the storm has come upon you sailors and so forth and upon this boat. And it's kind of interesting because what it indicates is they were able to look out and they could see the clear skies all around them. And instead of them being in the eye of the storm, they were the eye of the storm itself. I mean, there they were. They tried to paddle the way out, to oar the way out, and they couldn't get anywhere. They couldn't do anything. They were just totally trapped. And Jonah says, my fault. He said, I am a servant of the Most High God. He's God that's over the seas. He's over all the earth. And he said, just toss me into the ocean and everything will take care of itself. And they said, no. And they did everything they could to try to save him. He said, no, I'm the only hope. He said, I don't believe in committing suicide, but y'all can kill me. Just throw me overboard. And that'd be it. And sure enough, you know the story. They threw him overboard and then he was swallowed. He went on the first submarine ride that we have a recording of. Anyhow, he was swallowed. And while he was inside the belly of the well, he cried out to God and said, God, please forgive me. You know, he thought that was going to take care of the situation. He would die, go to God, that'd be all right. But it didn't happen. And he did meet with God, and he went through this storm. And in the storm, he prayed. And as he prayed, he ended up paying a tremendous price. But he finally got to go where God wanted to go to begin with. And so, exciting. But again, he paid a dear price for what happened because he refused to go where God told him to go to begin with. And he still, when he finally got there, he was so reluctant. And as a result of going where they're supposed to go, over 60,000 people got saved. Just amazing. It refers to the children that were saved and so forth too. But just amazing what happened as a result of him going, perhaps one of the greatest revivals ever recorded, as he went and he shared with these people. Yet he was so reluctant that he literally ran away from God. And folks, I don't know about you, but as a preacher, wouldn't be excited to have many people saved, to see that many lives changed, and a whole kingdom, a whole country, if you please, turned to God, who was so agnostic, so far against God, and worshiping false gods, to turn to the true God. And so again, what I'm saying is that God knows what's best for you. And many times, I'll put it this way, what's best for you is also best for a number of other people. A lot of times when heartaches and troubles come in our life, it doesn't affect just you, but it affects others that you love too that are involved with you. So it's important for us to not run away from God. Do what God asks you to do. And again, as we look at his word, he makes it very, very clear that yes, we need to be faithful to church. Yes, we need to be faithful in reading the word of God. Yes, we need to do what we can to bring others to Jesus Christ, to salvation. And we go on, God makes it so clear. So if we don't do any of those things, then we're running away from God. Then another thought comes to mind when I think about trouble. We ask for trouble when we pitch our tents towards Sodom and Gomorrah. In Genesis chapter 13, we have an interesting story about a man named Abram. And many of us know him as Abraham. And this man was had tremendous faith. And yet there's times that we see he had a lack of faith. And but yet when we see him in the right relationship with God, it's amazing how many people were blessed by him. And even to this day, people are blessed that they, if they bless the Jewish people, there's a blessing that comes, and it goes all the way back here to chapter 13 of Genesis. And so again, as we look at this message here in chapter 13 verse 11, we see what happens. Lot was the nephew to Abram, but because of the death of his family, he basically, Abram became his father, and they actually referred to each other that way. He referred to Lot as his son and so forth. And at that time, Abram had not had any children, actually. And so Lot was looked at as a son, and rightfully so, because he was raised by Abram. And so as we look here in chapter 3 and verse 11, notice what it tells us about the situation. Then Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves, the one from the other. And here's what happened. They were in the mountains. God was blessing. And everywhere that Abram went, he was blessed. His flocks were blessed. And things that he had, everything was multiplied over and over again. And Abram became a very, very wealthy person. And Lot, because of his close relationship with him, also gained from him because he was staying close to the right man, to a good man, to a godly man. And finally, some conflicts came. And it amazed that there'd be a problem in the family. And it amazed that the big division that would come about. And finally, Lot just said, Abram, I'm going to have to leave you. My herdsmen are fighting against yours. And then there's a question about this sheep. It really was mine, but you say it was yours or whatever. And they were going back and forth over all these things. And finally, Abram just looked in and said, okay, Lot, you choose where you want to go. And I'll go in the opposite direction. Folks, I think if Lot had really done what was right, I think he would have said, I'm sorry for what's happened, and I'm going to take care of this, and I want to stick close to you. You have been such a blessing to me, and you're getting older. I want to be a blessing to you and help you. I want to be your son. I want to, you know, do all these things, and I think that would have been the best thing. But he had his eye on a place called Sodom and Gomorrah. And he could hear every night, whenever he was in anywhere near that direction, he could hear the wild music that was going on and all the stuff. And they were just, it was party town, okay? And he could hear all these exciting things, and then he'd hear stories about what's happening. Some things maybe disturbed him a little bit. But finally he said, okay, I'll go to the well-watered plains and you can have the mountains, okay? Now, you think about it, you think that the older man should chose the easier way to go. But he gave him that choice. So he went down there. And of all things, when he went down there, he set his tent so that every time he stepped out, he could see the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. Wow.
for somebody that lived in the mountains and seen the beauty of God's handiwork. Then to look out and see, if you please, the beauty of the buildings of the city, the lure of the city. He looked out at it. In chapter 14, verse 12, again, we have Lot and his situation here. In 14:12 it says, "And they took Lot, Abram's brother's son, who dwelt in Sodom, and his goods, and departed." And so he went down there and he lived among these people. In other words, first he was looking at it, and then the next thing you know, he moved in with them. And it's amazing how people can read and say, well, you know, it's not really so bad what they're doing. And folks, Sodom and Gomorrah was involved in things that are happening in our country right now. They were what we refer to as sodomites. And basically, men were doing things with men that shouldn't be done, and women were doing things with women that shouldn't be done. They were doing things with animals. We can just go down the list. A lot of things that were happening. I didn't know children's church when we stayed here, so I won't go into any more detail. But what I'm trying to say is, it was unbelievable the terrible sins that were happening. And so, as a result, Lot, little by little, got more and more involved with it. And finally, as we look at his last picture of him, we find that he had become a leader within that land. But because of him living here, he was attacked by Chedorlaomer, and he took him with the five kings that were with him. He took him into captivity, and then of all things, Abraham came and pulled him out of the trouble and saved the people because of Lot. The whole cities of Sodom and Gomorrah were saved because of Lot and his presence, because of his uncle Abraham. But notice, verse 16, we see that they came back to the city. They've seen again that as long as they're close to Abraham, he's going to protect them. If anything happens, then Father Abraham, so to speak, is going to come to his aid and help him. And folks, isn't it great to know that as a Christian, that anytime we get in trouble, we can call on God? And how many times have we gotten in trouble because of something stupid we did? Something dumb that we... Why did we do that? But God is always ready to help us. And so finally, God, he sends his angels down and they speak to Abraham, tell him that he's going to have a special child. And as the Lord Jesus Christ is with him, it's what we call theophanies. As we find him there, he's talking to Abraham. He said, let's go ahead and tell him what's going to happen to Sodom and Gomorrah. And so they shared with him that the city was going to be destroyed. And Abraham, in his prayer, he began praying. He said, Father, if there's just 10 righteous, talk to his heavenly Father, if there's just 10 righteous, will you spare the city? And God said he would. Well, he prayed all the way down from 50 to 10. And God said he would spare. And of course, you know the story. When the angels arrived, the wicked men in the city tried to do terrible things to him. Wow, unbelievable. But as a result, when it was time to leave, Lot had the angels had to take his hand, and the hand of his wife, and the hands of his daughters, and lead him out of the city of Sodom and Gomorrah before the destruction came. Which, by the way, is a pretty good picture of the rapture. The Lord coming back and then taking the church out and leaving the world to itself. And wow, can you imagine what the world would be like if there was no Christians? And it would be a frightening place to live. And God has spared our country because of the Christians that we do have. And anyhow, moving along. It said that, verse 16, "And while he lingered," Lot was involved in the world so much so, "the men laid hold upon his hand, and upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, and the Lord being merciful unto him, and they brought him forth and set him without the city." So literally, it almost sounded like they were drugged out of that city. Could a Christian do that? The Bible tells us in Peter that Lot vexed his righteous soul. But God made it very clear that he was a man that knew Christ, his righteous soul. Wow. Isn't that amazing? And so he asked for trouble when he sat and faced his tent towards Sodom and Gomorrah. And then when he finally moved into the city, nothing but trouble to follow him. And God gave him several warnings to leave, and he continued to stay there. And then again, I think we ask for trouble when we touch God's anointing. And right now, a number of things have been happening in our country. a number of pastors, the quarantine and other things, if you want to call it that. It was really a political type thing. But when that was happening, a number of churches, especially in California, the pastors were locked up in jail, the churches were closed down for preaching the gospel, for preaching the truth. And we're going to see more and more. That's actually happened in Canada, too. The number of pastors were locked up for having church services with a controlled situation with the mask and everything else. And, of course, even here in our own town, we experienced some of that. And so, again, when we touch God's church, when we touch God's people, problems are going to follow. Notice what it says over here in Numbers chapter 22. And as we look here at Numbers, again, the people of Israel are just in the process of coming into the promised land. But because of sin, they were unable to go into the land. And so as a result of the sin, it caused them some real heartache. And folks, face it, whenever we sin, it's going to cause some heartache. It's going to cause some trouble to come in our lives. And notice what it says in verse 31. And the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and a sword drawn in his hand. And he bowed down his head and fell flat on his face. By the way, his donkey had just spoken to him and had shared with him what was happening. And the angel of the Lord said unto him, wherefore hast thou smitten thine ass these three times? Behold, I went out to withstand thee, because thy way is perverse before me. What was happening is Balaam had been paid to go curse the people of God. In other words, he'd been paid to go curse the church of that day, to put that church down, to please a man of the world, to please a politician named Balak. And so as a result of all this, God did everything he could to keep this man from going and cursing his people. This man that had some sort of relationship with God, and I don't understand it by any means. The king had said, if you'll go and curse him, I'll give you this much wealth. And he, I don't know if he put his hand up and said, I'll put gold all the way up to this part of your wall, whatever. But he promised him tremendous wealth if he would curse God's people. Folks, I wonder how many people have made money off the mask. You know? I wonder how many people have made money off of the vaccinations. I wonder how many people have made money off of the taking the test for to see if you have it or not have it. And I could just go on. And China's come out like a winner, even though they have been responsible for all this that's happened to us. Anyhow, you look at all these things, again, it is political. But this was political here. And so they stood against God's people. I don't know if you're aware, but here recently, because some people stood up because they were teaching critical race theory in their schools, they stood up in Virginia and other places and said, we don't want our kids to be taught that. Critical race simply says is that the white people of the world has subdued all the other races, and so now we need to take care. We need to rebel against the white people. And it's a Marxist teaching, and in other words, it's a communist teaching. And so as a result, that's what they're teaching in our schools, and then they've taken away all the wonderful things that have happened to make America what it is today. And they'll tell you that America was never great. And that America is a terrible place, and it's been run by racists, and on they go. They won't tell you the wonderful stories about George Washington, how God intervened in his life. And we can go on down the list of different great men that this country has had. But as a result, all that's been erased. So all they do is make people look like villains and cause division within our country. And so as we look here in our story here, we find that Balaam was asked to curse God's people. And so there's people out to destroy us. And so as a result of what's happened here, the FBI, the parents that went to these teachers' meetings, the FBI labeled them as domestic terrorists. They said they had no business standing against the school to teach them what the school wanted them to teach them, basically what the government wanted them to know. Virginia, it was so obvious when the past governor was running for governor there. He just stood up and he actually said this, and this is what and that cost him his job. He said, folks, let's face it, the government knows what's best for your children. You're just a bunch of dumb people. You don't know what's good for your children. And the government, we know what's best for your children. And so, man, put me in office and we'll make sure that your kids are taught right by the government, and you don't need to worry about them anymore. We'll take care. And the guy that won said, no, parents have a right to know what their kids are being taught. And anyhow, it was amazing how strongly he won. that very liberal state. But anyhow, what I'm trying to say, that it's happening all over. And as a result, people that are doing right, people that are Christian, are being labeled as domestic terrorists. Folks, I've got a lot of articles out there, so you don't believe me, that you can read. I got in trouble for doing this because I was quoting Epic Times. But anyhow, all this said, he was paid to go curse God's people. And there's people today that are being paid to curse us, to put us down, to destroy the Christians. And they're even talking about starting a re-educational program for re-educating Christians to help them to see that Christianity is a folly. Anyhow, we ask for trouble when we touch God's anointed. God will judge those people, and definitely Balaam was judged for his sin, and Balak was judged for his sin. Then we find again people like Pharaoh, who was king. He hated God's people, and he did everything he could to put them down and to put them in slavery. So we ask for trouble when we put down our brothers and sisters in Christ. We need to bless them and to encourage them to do and to continue to do that which is right. We find something else. We ask for trouble when we break our vows to God. And folks, I'll just ask some simple questions. Maybe some of you made a vow years ago, maybe it was at New Year's or whatever, you just said, God, I'll read a portion of your word every day. It may only be a verse, it may be a chapter, it may be four chapters, but every day I promise you that I'll read your word. Have you been faithful to do that? And then I think in terms of people that made vows and say, Lord, I'll give you a faith promise every week or every month, depending on how you're paid. I'll be faithful to give you a faith promise and give to you accordingly. And we could go on. And then maybe some of you have made vows concerning a partner. Have you been faithful to those vows? And those vows, were they made to God? And so again, we need to be careful. God says this in Ecclesiastes chapter 5. Better is it that thou shouldest not vow than that thou shouldest vow and not pay. So we find godly men in the Bible that broke their vows. Jacob broke a vow to the Lord. We find that Jonah broke his vow to the Lord. And we're going down the list, different ones, that they went ahead and did their own thing instead of doing what God would ask them to do. And then the Bible will use this for our last point today. But we ask for trouble when we try to hide our sins. In Proverbs 28:13 it says, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Adam tried to hide his sin, and of course he was in direct relationship with God. And as he tried to hide his sin, you know, the first thing he did, he basically said, well, the woman you gave me, and then the woman said, well, the snake that you put in the garden, and anyhow, they kept passing the buck. But folks, we need to confess our sins and get right with God. It's so important that we keep God right in our life. And so if there's a sin in our life, don't blame everybody else for that sin. And say, well, it's the society I've grown up in. Or, well, it's my folks. They did this and they did that, so that's why I've done what I did. Confess your sins, and God will have mercy. And folks, you know, I want y'all to be the most blessed people in the world. And I trust that this is your desire for everyone else, that you want them to be blessed. And sometimes we can go back to a sin that maybe you're trying to cover up, a sin that you're trying to hide. Folks, God knows about it. So why hide it? Go ahead and take care of it with God. Get things right so that God can bless you like he wants to. Many other stories in the Bible, men that tried to hide their sin. I think of Achan. He was an Israelite that he stole God's offering, basically, is what happened. And he came into tremendous judgment. But not only did it cost him, it cost his whole family because of his sin. Folks, I don't know about you. I know about me. I need God's blessings in my life. You ready? I want God's blessings in my life. I sure don't want the devil to bless me. Do you? And it's basically, if the devil does, it's going to be a curse, right? And so if there's things that I know that I'm supposed to do according to God's word, and I do those things, and I'm doing what God wants me to do, but if I don't do those things, I am guilty of running from God. and guilty of doing my own thing instead of what God would have me to do. And I'll be honest with you, I don't understand, like, for instance, tithing or giving. I don't understand how you can take the little bit that you have and give a portion of that to God, and then God can bless you. But over and over again, I've seen God do it. I've seen him do it for us over and over again, just do just amazing things. I think of my kids and blessing. I think of my son who's driving a $40,000 car that was given to him from the most unlikely source. Wow. By the way, cars are very expensive now. I don't know if you've been out price any lately. I think of all the vehicles I have. I guess almost all my vehicles were given to me by somebody. You know, and again, and I'm not talking about junk. I'm talking about some nice vehicles that God has given me. He's taking good care of me. But what I'm trying to say is that God wants to bless us. And can you think of a better advertisement than something like that? Well, God gave us this, God did that. I thank God for the house that he gave us. And again, we were able to pay cash for our house when we bought it. I mean, wow, who would have ever thought that, especially if you knew what my salary was? No way. But God, he takes care of us. And so I use those illustrations. And over again, my children that are involved in ministry can share story after story how God has blessed them in just unbelievable ways. I mean, unbelievable. God. We do what God says, and God can bless us. And if we don't, God can't bless us like he wants to. But you ready? We still belong to him, but he can't bless us like he wants to. It's just like with my children. When my children did right, I could bless them and be an encouragement to them. But when they did wrong, I couldn't. I mean, I still let them know I love them, but I wanted to help them, and I wanted them to do right so that they could be blessed of God. Wow. It's so simple, isn't it? But yet, it's so hard. Because it's so easy to go, well, everybody else says this. Why give to the church when you could do more with your own money than the church can? You got to realize we're talking about giving to God. And that, you ready? God will never be in debt to anybody. Isn't that fantastic? And he wants to show his greatness by blessing us. It's so sad that so many Christians can't be blessed because they're not doing what God would have them to do. And again, thank y'all for being here today, for being faithful to services. And many of you, I think it wasn't even a question. You didn't think, well, should we go to church today or not? And some of you, I think you actually get excited. Go, man, it's church day. It's church day. You know, and you look forward to coming and being here with us. And I appreciate that. Appreciate the smile I see on several faces here. And just thank for those that are here every time that you can be here. And you can remember that when the government had us locked down here, what a blessing that we can open our doors again and meet with brothers and sisters in Christ. So what am I saying? Are you in trouble because you asked for it? And really, I mean, how many of us would pray or say something like, oh God, I just haven't had enough trouble lately. Lord, I just really want to be in some serious trouble. Can you help me there? We're not going to do it. But many times the things that we do, that's what we're indicating, that we're, God, bless me, even though I'm not doing what you want me to do. Still bless me. And God said, I want to bless you. But I could bless you so much more if you did what I asked you to do. And for us to know what he wants to do and not do it, that is sin. Would you stand to your feet as we begin our invitation? Lord, thank you for this time we can come together and study your word. And Lord, I think of all the illustrations that are happening in the world right now. I think of Russia and Ukraine and all the terrible things that are happening there right now. And again, we see that this world is desperately wicked. It's just unbelievable the things that can happen because they follow the leadership of Satan. They follow the leadership of this world, of man, instead of following you. And Lord, help us to see the importance of doing right, whatever it might cost to do right, because it comes out so much better when we do what you want us to do. Lord, help us to see that we're not wise enough to handle our own lives, but we need your wisdom to help us, to guide us. We pray if there's someone here under the sound of our voice or through our electronic services here that doesn't know you as their Savior, that they might pray this simple childlike prayer and say, Dear God, please forgive me of all my sins and come into my heart and become my Lord and my Savior. May they pray that prayer in faith. And Lord, we're so thankful that you're ready and willing to answer that prayer and to make a difference in that person's life for all eternity. Thank you, Lord, again, for those that profess to know you as their Savior here in the service today. We pray that you'll encourage them for doing that which is right. We pray for our folks that are unable to be here today, for whatever reason it might be, that you would keep them safe and that they'll soon be able to be back with us. Lord, we pray that you'll help us as we serve you. May we truly be a shining light in this dark world. May we help people, because everywhere people are in trouble. They're in terrible trouble. And you're the only one that can help us in these troubles to find what needs to be found, and that's a relationship with you. Thank you again for loving us. Have your way and will with this invitation. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Have somebody back there at the sound equipment, so I don't know how I came across them, if they're able to turn me up, turn me down, or turn me off.
Your mic,
I think your mic just turned off itself because there was nothing back there.
Oh, there's nothing
back
there. Okay.
Your mic went off about halfway through.
Oh, it did. Yeah. Okay, mm-hmm. Maybe my battery died, so sorry about that. Trey, that's busting ears out, so
that's all right. We can still hear you.
You can still hear me. Thank you, brother. Yeah. Appreciate that. So, well, we want to go ahead and dismiss in prayer at this time. And again, it's so good to have you here. So many people to pray for. And so let's keep each other in prayers. And I'm going to ask Brother Chuck. And again, Brother Chuck is still homeless at the site. And we've done what we can to help him. And we're hoping things will work out soon. Any progress report right now, Brother Chuck?
Well, I tried to call the company that said they'd finance it, but they were closed over the weekend, so I got to try to call them back Monday. But
okay.
The best I can figure out, the last time I talked to her, she said 120 days was in that area. And from what I gathered, I must have contacted them about the 16th of January, so I think I'm still within the coverage area. So I'm going to call them again tomorrow.
Okay.
But as far as I know, we'll probably get the place okay. So.
Okay.
And we'll move in on the 1st of April.
Okay, so you'll pray for them to put them here close to home again.
Country Meadows.
Yeah, Country Meadows. So anyhow, we're just praying that it'll work out for them. And it's been so hard trying to find something in this area. It's just not out there. And then what is out there costs so much. It's just unbelievable how high things have gone. And of course, our president right now, the vice president, said all because of Putin. He's caused all this trouble.
What about
that's weird. I thought the war started 3 weeks ago, but it goes all the way back. So I guess everybody knew it was going to happen.
15 months.
And what amazes me is how many people will believe that. That's
oh,
what
yeah.
amazes me. So anyhow, we need to pray for each other. So I call him Brother Chuck, and also he's, most of you know, he was in the Navy, and then he repented and joined the Army like Bob did. So the first time. But anyhow, I want him to pray for us at this time, and of course, your situation too. So Brother Chuck, would you pray for us?
Thank you again, Heavenly Father, for the Lord today. We thank you for the message brought today, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to watch over us, that we would continue to serve you, Lord. And we love you so much, and we know that you love us even more. We look forward to that day of eternity with you. We just thank you for your many, many blessings, Lord, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen.